So let's start with Peter. Managing money, and let's focus on the resource sector. The more money you have, it's more difficult for the returns. Of the companies in this, do you invest in junior exploration companies?
Well, personally, well, I have a fund, which unfortunately Canadians can't buy. It's managed by Adrian Day, the Euro-Pacific Precious Metals Fund.
And an old...
And in that fund, we do buy quite a bit of junior mining companies. Although, you know, I've learned a lesson the hard way. We have to sell a lot of these exploration companies that we generate. I think we had the number one gold fund last year. We did extraordinarily well. And some of the picks that Adrian bought were exploration companies. But one of the problems that we have in the United States is the Internal Revenue Service. And they have something called a PIFIC, a passive foreign investment company. And it was originally designed to prevent Americans from investing in foreign mutual funds by creating a prohibitively a repressive taxation system. But apparently, all these mining exploration companies fall into the category of PIFIC. If they keep their working capital in the bank and they earn even one Canadian dollar worth of interest, then they're now considered a passive foreign investment company because they have no revenues because they're an exploration company. So all their revenues come from interest. And so basically Americans can't buy those stocks. And so we're actually having to sell a lot of those companies that we liked in order, because the tax treatment means if you buy a PIFIC at a dollar and at the end of the year it's at $2, that's $1 of ordinary income that you have to pay, you know, 40% tax on, even if you haven't sold the stock, even if the company itself is losing money. So it's a really horrific...
It's absurd.
Yeah, so, but as an American, you know, I have to stay. Well, I can't buy any resource, any exploration companies, personally, because I don't want any of those PIFICs. So I buy mainly, you know, producing companies personally.
Now, Dan, I know you through the market. You run one of the largest funds in the sector. How do you go about it? Because you manage so much money, you can't be allocating a $250,000 here, a $250,000 there. You're writing $30-50 million checks.
Yeah. By definition. As a private equity fund, we're kind of paid to take concentrated bets on things. So in our second fund, which is $476 million, we'll have six or seven main investments that we'll make in that fund. So hence the reason we do a ton of work to understand resources, a ton of work to...
So you're running your own assays, you're doing your own metallurgy...
You were often bringing in external views on metallurgy. We're more often than not rebuilding block models, or at least having independent people go and verify block models. You know, you're looking at mine plans. Like it's a full scale M&A type due diligence when we get into these things. So, okay. For us that means that we're not great momentum investors. You know, it's tough for us to buy something and sell it quickly.
Because of the size of your fund.
Because of the size of the fund, and part of it's the makeup of our investors, right? Our investors are large U.S. corporate pension funds, university endowments, and they're committing money for 10 years. And they don't want a quick flip because then they kind of have to find some other place to reinvest that money. So when we sell something, we send the capital back. And then if it's less than a year, we can recall it. But if it's not, then, you know, it's gone, which is great. The whole incentive is for us then to generate great returns and go out and raise another fund. But they're far more happy with, something that would be a 40% IRR over 5 years than they would be a 60% IRR over 1 year.
Gotcha. Now, Peter, as a money manager, what lessons can you share on market volatility? Because I'm a big believer that we're going to see more what I call violent financial shocks rather than the gradual cycle we've seen in these markets, just because of the, you know, whether you want to call it Trump factor, the geopolitical factors, or the financial instability. What lessons have you learned about that?
Well, I mean, sometimes obviously the volatility creates the opportunities because you have an opportunity to buy at a price that, absent that volatility, might not be available to you. But, you know, more so than just volatility, I think from an investor or a contrarian perspective, the biggest opportunities to make money is when you can find a trade or a conventional wisdom that you know is wrong, right? Something that is universally believed by the vast majority of investors, and you understand that they're wrong. And by betting against that conventional wisdom, that's how you can make the most amount of money. But it's often very difficult because you're always early, right? If you notice something that other people don't, right, it takes a while before the fundamentals will rear their head. So you got to be willing to be wrong. You know, one of the examples of that was, you know, the subprime market in the United States. I mean, I knew there was a housing bubble, and I argued with people for years about the bubble and the cause of the bubble and what was going to happen when it burst, but nobody could see it. Everybody thought that, you know, real estate prices would continue to rise and that there was no threat to the economy. And that's why that trade was so profitable for us in 2007 when it finally blew up. And the reason that so few people were able to make so much money is because the vast majority of people were clueless.
So give us, I want to expand this. So what's your next big conviction trade?
Yeah, I mean,
the next housing bubble crisis.
Yeah, so all the people who didn't see the bubble coming, who didn't understand the housing bubble and didn't know what caused it, are now convinced that the Federal Reserve solved the problem. They don't understand that the Fed created the bubble and that the financial crisis of 08 was a consequence of the prior monetary mistakes. But the same people who thought that didn't see the bubble coming now think the problems that caused it have been cured, and they couldn't be more wrong. I mean, for a while, people were nervous. When I was out there criticizing the Fed for its monetary policy, for its zero interest rates and QE, initially people maybe thought I was right. That's why, you know, initially the price of gold went up to 1900. People actually started to doubt the Fed, and they thought that maybe the policy would end the disaster, and people started buying gold. But after about 2013, everybody started to believe that the Fed was right, and that people like me who were criticizing what the Fed was doing, we were wrong. Right? And people then believed, yes, you know, this is Ben Bernanke was on the cover of magazines. He's the hero. He's the savior. And now all of a sudden the dollar had a big rally because people were betting that the Fed was right. Oh, they're going to be able to normalize interest rates. They're going to shrink their balance sheet. Gold started to come down because there's never going to be any inflation. All the people who were worried about inflation were wrong. And so you have everybody now that was blinded by the financial crisis. Once again, completely convinced that everything is fine, that the U.S. economy is in great shape. The reason that Donald Trump is the president is because the U.S. economy is a disaster. But the powers that be on Wall Street still haven't figured that out, and they still have these pro-USA bets going on. They're long U.S. stocks, they're short gold, they're long the dollar, and they're just as wrong now. The bubble that we have now is much bigger than the housing bubble. It's much bigger than the stock market bubble during the dot-com era. I mean, it's a stock market bubble, it's a housing bubble, it's a bond bubble combined, and you have bubbles thrown in autos and college degrees. I mean, everything that can be financed with debt is in a bubble because we've had interest rates at zero for so long. I mean, if you think about the magnitude of the housing bubble, that was created by 1% interest rates that were there for about a year, year and a half. And then by the fact that it took the Fed a couple of years to get back from 1% to 5%, that monetary policy gave us the housing bubble, which brought about the financial crisis of 2008, which but for the bailout supposedly was going to be worse than the Great Depression. So if the Fed was able to do that much damage, keeping rates at 1% for a year, think about how much more damage has been done keeping them at zero for eight. And with all the rounds of quantitative easing, so we are on the verge of a much bigger crisis, yet nobody sees it coming.
Okay,
but
so
if you position yourself right,
Let's talk about positioning. So we see the setup, we kind of get it. How can someone in the retail audience make money off this? So give us some ideas. Long gold or...
Gold, obviously, gold went to 1900 when people were worried about a lot of inflation. Imagine how high it's going to go when it actually hits. Right? Because whether we end up with a hyperinflation or not, inflation is going to be much higher than these so-called 2% targets that all these central banks have around the world. So gold's going a lot higher. But, you know, there are a lot of stock markets around the world that I think are relative safe havens. I think that there are countries where the fundamentals are much better than, let's say, in most of the major European economies or Japan or the United States. There are countries around the world where there are good stock markets, and that's where I generally try to invest. I try to find good companies, countries maybe like New Zealand or Singapore, Norway, Hong Kong, Switzerland. I mean, there's some countries, South Korea, some parts of South America or Southeast Asia, where you can find good companies in countries that I think are very well positioned for a major realignment of exchange rates. I mean, everybody somehow is still optimistic on the dollar. We have a huge dollar bubble. This is bigger than the dollar bubble that popped in 2001. You know, it's ironic that Bill Clinton handed George Bush a dollar bubble. Well, Obama is handing Trump an even bigger one. And the U.S. economy is fundamentally much weaker than it was in 2000. And so there's a lot more air in this bubble. And when it comes out, it's going to have substantial implications for the world and living standards around the world and asset values. And so what you need to do is be positioned in the countries that are going to be on the receiving end of this huge transfer.
So can there be a U.S. dollar bull market and a gold price bull market? Can the two happen?
There could be, but
what other currencies
be.
Would you rather own than U.S. dollar? You don't want to own the peso. The Canadian dollar struggles with commodities. You ain't going to own the ruble. So what can you? What's better than the dollar?
People had the same attitude in 2000 when the dollar index was 120. And then it fell for seven straight years down to 70. And it would have kept falling if it wasn't saved by the financial crisis. So, you know, the U.S. economy is in worse shape than Europe. It's in worse shape than Japan. The only reason the dollar's gone up is because people buy it. Right? It's kind of like a self-perpetuating trade. People ignore the lousy fundamentals and they just buy it anyway. But once it turns, the dollar has been falling since 1971. I mean, it's been in a major long-term bear market, but that doesn't stop it from rallying every once in a while. And every time it rallies, people get optimistic, and then the next thing you know, it goes down and makes a new record low. And I think the next time the dollar falls, I think it's going to be out for the count. And, you know, is it could gold rise when the dollar? Look, gold was up last year and the dollar was up. So gold doesn't need the dollar to be weak to go up, but a weak dollar is much better for gold than a strong dollar. So I think gold will gain a lot more when the dollar is weak. But I expect the price of gold to rise in every currency because, as you said, they're all flawed. They're all sinking in value. It's just that I think the dollar is going to sink a lot faster than most of the other currencies. But there are currencies that I think, like I mentioned New Zealand, I mentioned Singapore, I mentioned Norway. Those currencies, I think, are going to be, they're going to lose less value.
So is gold money to Peter Schiff?
Hmm?
Is gold money?
Well, gold is money, right?
And everything silver? Is silver money too?
Sure. Well, silver is money. I mean, paper, dollars, euros, yen, they were never money. They were money substitutes. Right, a money substitute currency, you know, like the dollar used to be gold, and Federal Reserve notes would be money substitutes. They were currency that circulated, but they represented warehouse receipts for real money, which was the gold. What gave paper currency value was the gold that backed it up. But right now, all we have is, you know, fiat. We don't have any real legitimate currencies anywhere in the world, but we do have gold as money. And incidentally, you know, gold today, people can use gold as money today easier than they can at any point in the history. Because you can now, there's a company called Gold Money. Unfortunately, they don't have their booth here, but you can go to their website, goldmoney.com. You can buy gold online through Gold Money. They sell it at a 0.5% over spot. And once you have that gold, it's now as liquid as the dollars in your bank account. You can use it in commerce, you can buy things with it, you can spend it, you can buy a cup of coffee or you can buy a car. You can invoice your customers, you can get paid in gold, you can earn gold, you can save gold, you can spend it instantaneously anywhere around the world, either directly using your gold or they'll give you a free debit card, a MasterCard, and you could just use your MasterCard and when you swipe it, you're spending your gold as opposed to your currency. But with the internet and gold, there's no reason, nobody needs central banks anymore. Because if you can take your gold and you can use it worldwide as money across borders, if I can instantaneously buy something in New Zealand and pay for it in gold, and the person selling it to me can be paid in gold and it costs nothing. So, and I think as more and more people recognize that these money substitutes that these central banks are creating are flawed, right? Why own currency, put it in the bank, earn 0% interest, and hope that if the bank fails, the government can somehow bail it out, when you can just have gold stored in your own vault You don't have to worry about any failures because the gold is there and you can spend it as easily.
What about Russian hackers?
Well, how can they hack it? It's actual physical gold stored in a vault. There's nothing to hack. It's your gold stored by Brinks in a vault. It's just that with the gold money platform, your gold is liquid, right? I have in my wallet a debit card that is linked to my gold money account. This one is actually made of pure gold. So it's about $1,500 worth of gold in this debit card. But this is a real gold card, right? It's not one of these phony gold cards. But I think people around the world, when they realize, you know, there are a lot of people that use, how many people use Uber now? You know, or Airbnb or, you know.
We don't have that FedEx. Yet in Vancouver.
Yeah, well, you know, it's like, you know, government doesn't work, right? Government, monopoly, cabs are too expensive. A lot of people in America use
FedEx. But Peter, the reality is less than 0.2% of the global financial markets are investing in actual physical gold. So I'm with you. I'm one of the largest.
I'm not talking about investing in gold. I'm talking about gold is money.
I know,
money,
but right?
So
but
what,
the retail person, I want to get into money managing. We're, this is not an right. economist panel. But what worries me is the government's telling you guys what you can and can't invest in from a money management. That was very alarming about not allowing you guys to invest in junior exploration companies.
Well, that's a problem with the Internal Revenue Code. But just the final point I wanted to make on gold is, it's not about investing in gold. It's about using gold for what it's actually supposed to be, which is money. That's the real value. I mean, sure, gold can be used in jewelry, it can be used in electronics, it can be used in medicine. There are a lot of uses for gold. But the best use for gold is money, because government money doesn't work. It loses value by design, right? Central banks say that their goal is 2% inflation. That means their goal is that your money loses 2% of its value every year. Well, money's supposed to be a store of value. Well, government fiat doesn't store value, but gold does. And I think people all around the world are going to rediscover gold, and I think individually people will go on a gold standard. Even if the governments don't want to do it, the people will vote for their feet, right? Just like they use FedEx instead of the post office.
So Trump in power, what do you see changing for gold with Trump in power?
Well, you know, Trump is going to be, look, there's going to be a lot of inflation. What's going to happen with Donald Trump, right? The budget deficits are going to go way up, right? Because Trump wants to cut taxes for the middle class, very popular. He wants to increase spending on defense. He wants to increase spending on the border. He wants to increase spending on infrastructure. He wants to allow entitlements to continue to run out of control. Meanwhile, interest rates are rising, so interest on the debt is rising. So we're going to see budget deficits getting close to $2 trillion a year. Remember, Obama doubled the debt from $10 trillion to $20 trillion. Bush doubled it from 5 to 10. So in order to keep this bubble going, Trump's got to do the same thing, only the numbers are enormous. So I expect lots of money printing. I think the Fed's going to go back down with rates.
But a question, if they've kicked the can so far down and they're creating the rules of the game, it's kind of like being in space. There's no end to it. When does it end? Because you would have thought 5 years ago, there's no way the system will collapse at $20 trillion debt. Everyone would agree. If you opened up a newspaper today and said, Trump's in power, $20 trillion in debt, we're a mess, the world's in a financial mess, you would think gold would be $5,000 today. Why isn't it?
Because,
I think there's a whole bunch of other things that I would add other than just the U.S. debt. If you said last year, you know, Russia was going to annex the Crimea, that's World War III
Brexit,
stuff.
Or Brexit.
Growing up, right?
Or so Brexit. Why isn't gold at $5,000? Are we the crazies? And are we wrong for believing in gold?
No, listen, I think it's a little bit of what Peter's talking about being early on your view, you know? I think there's still a lot of that game to play. But listen, we don't, as money managers, we don't occupy ourselves all that much with the great macroeconomic factors, to tell you the truth. What we occupy ourselves with and what our investors pay us for are to go through interesting mining projects and great companies and great people and try and put enough money in to solve a problem with a company, reach some milestones, achieve some value, and really build some things. So we, you know, we have the luxury and responsibility of having to deploy big licks of capital into things.
But okay, so you're bullish on gold, Dan.
Yeah, listen,
what about coal? Are you bullish on coal? Are you even allowed to buy coal because endowment funds?
You know, it's interesting.
People are setting
your
rules.
No, it's interesting you say that, because I don't think we'd buy thermal coal because a bunch of our limited partners are U.S. university endowments who have, you know, football fields full of students marching on the endowment office telling them that they don't want them to invest in fossil fuels. So for us, that, you know, we're going to make our LPs' lives very
difficult. Or Norway, who's created their whole sovereign wealth fund from oil, and now they're eliminating investing in fossil fuel.
Yeah, listen, that's great diversification for them because they still have a long tail exposure to it. So that's fine. No, but for us, like hard coking coal, absolutely. Because I'll tell you, and, you know, not all met coal is hard coking coal. We have a great project in BC that we own a big chunk of privately.
So what other commodities? You're bullish on gold.
Listen, I'm bullish for the reasons that Peter's talking about on the macro picture. I'm bullish on almost every commodity. But we spend most of our time taking demand growth as kind of an assumption, right? If global GDP growth over a 10-year period is 2 to 3%, then commodities are going to do fantastically. Yeah. Because what most of the world doesn't focus on is the supply side.
That's right.
And they just don't understand that, A, no one is spending money exploring for new projects. Well, you know, exploration, greenfields exploration is at a 10-year low this year. So no one is spending the money on it. No one's finding anything. Even when they spend a lot of money on it, they're not finding anything.
Got to go deeper and farther.
Deeper and farther.
Unfortunately, the big deposits are in places that the North American companies have no advantage because it's either the Russians or the Chinese. So, Peter, what other commodities are you bullish on specifically other than gold and silver?
Well, first, I just wanted to backtrack one thing on gold quickly. Because you say, is it crazy to think gold's going to go to 5,000? I remember when I was predicting gold 1,000, and people thought I was crazy because it was under 300. So this bull market started right in 2000. And now, you know, it's had a correction within this bull market. But 5,000 is only, a triple from here. That's not much. I mean, considering, you know, gold went that
since
first
the debt's
leg,
doubling every administration.
The first leg, gold went from under 300 to almost 2,000. Right? It went up for 13 straight years or 12. Then, it's paused for a few years. So, you know, what's crazy is thinking it's not going to go there, right? Not understand the fundamentals. But, you know, one of the reasons why a lot of commodities are going to go up, right? A lot of industrial commodities are going to go up, a lot of metals and energy prices, is if I'm right on what I think is going to happen to the dollar, and I am right, that is a massive reduction in prices for a good portion of the world. I think a lot of the emerging economies that have massive populations, I think that the overvalued dollar has substantially depressed demand in those economies because they can't afford to buy things because their exchange rates are too low. And the idea that the dollar is going to keep rising is putting a lot of pressure on emerging markets because a lot of these companies have a lot of dollar debt. And when the dollar goes up, that increases the burden of servicing that debt, of repaying that debt. It causes capital flight. So once the dollar really reverses and the psychology reverses, that's going to provide tremendous relief to these emerging market economies. And there you've got, you know, hundreds of millions or billions of consumers that are suddenly going to be enriched. And yes, maybe Americans will be impoverished, but there's only 300 million of us, right? If you take the rest of the world and all of a sudden, you know, their wages are more valuable, their savings is more valuable, they're going to want to buy a lot of stuff. And a lot of the stuff that they're going to want to buy is going to be resource intensive. You know, when an American buys a car, he already has a car. We don't, you know, but if someone in China buys a car, he's turning in a bicycle, right? So there's a lot more, you know, metal and a lot more raw materials when people who have nothing suddenly can buy something.
So what percentage, it's a classic thing, buy low, sell high, great. Okay, well, it's a lot easier to say than do. We're all money managers. What percentage of cash though, because when it crashes, it never crashes on schedule or on your time. You're saying it's going to happen, but it could happen in 3 days or 3 years. Nobody knows. How do you manage your cash position, Dan? Because you got $476 million, and you're talking about investing in five or six companies, concentrated bets.
Yeah.
How do you manage the cash, and what percentage of cash are you? And what would you share with your audience, with our audience here, how to manage your cash? Yeah. Never be fully invested, be 50% invested. Like, what?
Yeah,
you learn.
We've learned some hard lessons through the course of our first fund, which is running to the end of its 10th year, in that we were mostly invested after five or six in 2011 when things rolled over. And in a perfect world, to be honest, we should have sold a lot more. We didn't. But we got into a position as a fund where we didn't have the capital to support or take advantage of opportunities in some of our core investments in the downturn. So that's a real lesson learned. But you know, keep in mind, our fund is committed capital that gets called, deployed.
So it's not an open-ended fund.
Not an open-ended fund.
Be careful about investing in open-ended funds in the resource sector because of the psychology. Everyone's bullish at the top, and when you should be investing, people ask for their capital back. So Peter, how do you manage your cash percentage in the funds that you're involved with?
We manage a lot of separately managed accounts. So each individual client has an account, and then we manage it as an individual account. I do have 5 mutual funds. They're not hedge funds, so they're and they're open-ended funds. So potentially they can have those problems where we get a lot of money in when the market is high, because people tend to invest in the rearview mirror, right? They look at the funds and they buy the Morningstar fund that has 5 stars, and it's probably got 5 stars because it's loaded up with all the overvalued assets, right? You should be looking at the ones that have the 1 star, like, because maybe they're buying something that that is being overlooked. But when we're managing separately managed accounts, other people's investments aren't going to influence the value of your account. And I manage these accounts. I have my Canadian broker dealer here is Echelon Wealth Partners. We used to be called Euro Pacific Capital, but I got outvoted, so they changed the name. But Echelon is the new name. But I still manage portfolios for clients of Echelon through my asset management company, because Canadians can't buy my mutual funds because they're not registered here. But they can be clients of Echelon, and I can manage their portfolios for them.
To answer my own question, I'm over 50% cash of that. About 3/4 is US dollars, 1/4 is Canadian dollars. And it's about you can't take advantage of a pullback or an opportunity. Luck is being prepared when the opportunity arises. We've got 5 minutes. This is an entertaining crowd, very experienced panelists. And we're going to get another 30 minutes of Peter and his excitingness on the next panel. But let's open it up 5 minutes for questions. So don't be shy. And let's challenge Peter's thoughts if you want to. You know me, I like to create a contrarian view. Yes, sir.
Maron, I'd like to ask you why you're so skewed to cash at this particular time.
We've had an incredible run. I'm paying out a 55% dividend after fees. And I love cash. Last year at this show, everyone asked me, I said cash is king. So you have to have cash to allocate when the market's bad. And we went very big last year, and it's been a great run, and I'm positioning myself for the next run. Yes, sir.
What is the reasoning for investing money with your funds rather than viewing the holdings and investing it ourselves?
Sure. So the question now, Dan, can people even invest with PacRo? I don't think so. Unless you're like a sovereign wealth fund.
Yeah, no, we have a few smaller investors and people who aggregate investments through other investment advisors, people like Cambridge Associates and groups like that, who basically group small pension funds, family offices, things like that.
Okay. Peter?
Yeah, certainly a lot of the stocks that we buy are pretty hard to buy unless you have the right relationships to trade in a lot of the global markets that I trade in. And I also find that a lot of times when you try to access global markets, you get market makers interposed between you and the stock. And so often cases, you end up paying much higher prices. But assuming that you had access to all the same exchanges and you could get the same FX rates as us and the same brokerage rates, the question is, do you think that my portfolio managers are going to make better decisions than you could? And it depends, what you do for a living. A lot of my clients, they're doctors or lawyers, they're running a business. They don't want to analyze stocks on their own. They want somebody else to do it for them. They want somebody else to read the balance sheets and to follow the companies and to decide when to buy and when to sell. So, there are a lot of things that you could do yourself, right? But or you can hire somebody else to do it for you. And so it would depend on your circumstances. But I hire a lot of professionals. I don't diagnose my own illnesses. I don't, I have a dentist, I have a doctor, I have lawyers. So a lot of people, specialize in some things. And most people, aren't going to specialize in asset management. And a lot of people are retired. They're on vacation. They want to, travel. They don't want to have to take a screen with them and follow their stocks. I got guys that do nothing but monitor our positions, right? I have portfolio managers. We pick the stocks. We stay in touch with the companies.
Competitive advantage. You built the infrastructure and you have the experience to do it. Whereas if you're going solo, you have to ask yourself, how am I better than the guys up who have the network and the competitive advantage. So that's a question to ask for each, every one of you. Yes, sir.
Yes, this question is for Peter. I remember many years ago that when you spoke and you were bearish on the US dollars, you were bullish on the gold, you were bullish on emerging market, but I think for the last 4 to 5 years, everything is going the opposite directions. So first, I think I'm not sure about your performance, but if you manage to still perform and I know you're early in your forecast, how do you manage during this time, the volatility?
How do you survive until the time is right? The question.
Well, I mean, this trade has been a long time in evolving, right? Because I started my way of thinking in the late 1990s. And so if you want to look at the cycles, right, from when I first started getting worried about the Fed and Greenspan's policies was in the second half of the 1990s. And so the early part, I was early. And so I underperformed from 1997 to 2000. Then we killed it from 2000 to 2008, not counting the subprime trade, which was separate. We had fantastic returns. 2008, we went down with everybody else. Then 2009, 2010, 2011, we did extremely well. Then when we had the rise in the dollar and the fall in gold, the bad years were 2012, 2013, 14, 15. We had a great year last year. I mean, our strategy bottomed out in January of 2016. So we had a great run in 2016. We're already way outperforming the US market, the S&P or the NASDAQ so far in 2017. In fact, 2017, we're off to a much better start than 2016. And even though we had great returns in 2016, I think that was just a down payment on the returns we're gonna get. I think this is another big run. I think the dollar is topping. I think gold is bottomed. I think the resource sector is bottomed. And I think, you know, this false paradigm, this bubble is about to deflate, and this is gonna be another big move. Now, had I been smart enough to anticipate the severity of the correction, maybe I could have, you know, tried to sidestep those few years. But I mean, it's always difficult to do that. In hindsight, it's very easy. Oh yeah, I should have sold here and I could have bought back in over here. But you know, it's hard to anticipate, you know, what is gonna happen. I mean, like I could have bought into the .com stocks.
We could have, should have, would have, but we're going to have to end this panel.
And it's so hard to do it when you know it's a bubble. It's easy to do it when you don't know it's a bubble. If you're it's just as dumb as everybody else, then you just buy it. But it's hard to buy something that you know is going to collapse. And so, you know, that keeps me out of the bubbles. But, I mean, I'm not in them when they pop.
So what we're going to do is we're now going to get to the gold forecast part.